All right, AP US History. So welcome back. We are now going to begin talking about period six. This is basically the end of the 1800s and beginning of the 1900s. So we are going to be getting into first the post-Civil War industrial growth. So all the big things that are happening after the Civil War, but before World War I. All right. So this is also a time period that's going to be known as the Gilded Age. So we have a time of serious social problems, and it's going to be just overshadowed by this very thin layer of like gold. It's going to look all glitzy and glamorous, but it's actually really dark and dingy and grimy, and a lot of unpleasant things happen during this time period. All right. So some of those things that we're going to be talking about, like politically, we are going to see that, they're going to be promoting a lot of post-war industrial growth. So we have like the Morrill Tariff, which is going to reestablish high protective rates. Also, freedom from foreign competition would be a help. You know, since we're on two big oceans, it's kind of just protecting American businesses in the overseas trade. We're going to see the National Banking Act of 1863. This is going to provide a satisfactory banking system and a uniform national bank note. So we're going to have more secure money. You know, it's going to be more uniform across the whole country. There's going to be creation of a lot of railroad companies during this time, and the subsidies in the form of land grants and loans to, you know, a good 42 transcontinental railroads. Like we have, of course, the major one that everyone hears about, but there are plenty of other railroads that get built going across the country. All right, this is going to be a huge boost in how industrialization happens in the country. We're going to see protection of businesses happening. So state governments, they couldn't interfere in business at the state level, according to the 14th Amendment, which would like nationalize things. The Supreme Court is going to recognize corporations as persons or as people in the eyes of the law, and extended to them the special protection against the federal government. So basically, we're going to see more of a laissez-faire or hands-off type of situation happening with business. So not a lot of regulation. They can kind of get away with whatever they want. So yeah, not exactly good by today's standards, because that means we're going to see things like a lot of abuses towards the people who work for these companies. All right, some economic factors. We're going to see these promoting economic industrial growth. So the United States has abundant natural resources. We have tons of it, lots of fertile soil, you know, for growing crops. We have lots of forests, so we have tons of lumber available. There are lots of coal and iron mines. There's a lot of oil fields that are being discovered. Gold and silver and copper deposits in different mountain ranges across the country are still being found. So there's a lot of stuff that can be used for growing the country economically and industrially. We're going to see investment money, which is what investment capital means. It's money for investing, coming from war profits and from European investors. The West also is going to produce fortunes from the gold and silver mines, which is going to be put into circulation. So there's just more money available to people. We're going to see a large supply of cheap labor because we have the war veterans who need jobs. We have immigrants coming from overseas looking for new opportunities in America. A lot of immigrants are going to be this huge unskilled labor force after the Civil War ends in 1865. All right. So also new technologies are going to be coming available, and it's going to allow for mass production of cheap goods. So more stuff coming out faster, and it's less expensive. So that's going to help boost the market as well. We're going to see improved transportation and faster communications. So that's like railroads for faster travel, steamboats for the rivers. We're going to see the telegraph, which is basically the first version of a text message, because you're sending an electronic message from one location to another that is read off of a machine. So yeah, it's pretty cool. Now, you know, post-war industries, that's a whole nother factor. We're going to see the steel industry with the introduction of the Bessemer process really just blow up in, you know, production and boosting the economy. Now, for those of you who do not know what the Bessemer steel process is, this is an example of a Bessemer, like, it's like an oven for cooking up steel. So the raw iron will go into the in through the top here into the tank. It is going to be, you know, superheated to where the iron melts and we got molten iron, but it's going to have air come up and blast it into it, which is going to superheat it in the vessel. And it is going to just burn white hot, and it's going to burn away all the impurities. And that is going to really be what turns it into steel. All right, so moving on. Let's talk about the free enterprise system. This is basically individuals, we're free to produce and sell whatever we want. And we're also free to buy and use whatever we can afford. So kind of like the system we have now, but a lot less government control. There's basically no government control to regulate trade to make it fair. So it's the freest version of an economy, but doesn't exactly mean it's good. All right, next, let's talk about social Darwinism. So this is basically the idea that, you know, talking about Darwinism, you know, the theory of evolution, the strongest is the one that survives. The same thing can be applied to societies, and that's what social Darwinism is. So basically, like the comic here says, survival of the richest. So like the strongest societies, the wealthiest societies are the ones that survive. Anything that's like wasting away, they die off, and then, you know, we just move on. That's essentially what it's saying. All right. So another comic showing like us being like, hey, we're the ones in charge. We know what we're doing. What are y'all doing? All right. Let's talk about immigration and urbanization. This is going to be a big part of that post-war economy boost. All right. So after the Civil War, we're going to see a big second wave of like a surge of immigration coming to the United States. And this is going to go basically from the 1890s until the beginning of World War One in 1914. And we're going to see, you know, the U.S. the population boost dramatically, all right, with immigration. So we're going from like 23.2 million in 1850 for immigrants up to 76.2 million in 1900. That is a huge increase in immigration, all right? Now, these new immigrants mostly are coming from Southern and Eastern Europe. So that's going to be places like Italy, Greece, Russia, Slovakia, Poland, you know, places like that. And they're going to be a lot of poor, illiterate people. Think your poor farmers who couldn't make much of a living over there, so they thought they'd try their luck here. A lot of them do not speak English. They're leaving countries that are, you know, under like a monarchy type rule, so like kings and queens, stuff like that. A lot of them are Roman Catholic, Greek Orthodox, Russian Orthodox, Jewish. So very different religiously from, you know, the regular Protestantism that we have here in the United States, like our Baptists, our Lutherans, our, you know, all those types of groups, you know. Now, for these immigrants, there are push and pull factors. What's pushing them to leave their home countries is, you know, poverty, overcrowding, a lot of joblessness is going on, religious persecution, especially for Jewish people in Eastern Europe. But we're also seeing a lot of pull factors here anyway. You know, we have a reputation for political and religious freedoms, especially compared to a lot of other countries. Economic opportunities in the big cities and out west, you know, you can go out west with nothing, just about, you know, maybe like $5 in your pocket. Next thing you know, you might have a pretty profitable and big ranch on your hands after just several years. You never know. And a lot of cultural ties to those who came before them. So there are already groups from these countries already in the U.S. so they can help ease you in and teach you what you need to know. Now, of course, with the good, there comes the bad. We also get what is called the nativism movement, which was basically all these people in America who were trying their best to limit or keep out immigrants as much as possible because, you know, they're taking our jobs, they're doing this, they're doing that, we don't want them here. So we're going to see a number of laws being passed that are going to basically limit the ability of immigrants to come to America and what they can do one if they're actually here. All right. Now, one of the big ports that immigrants are going to come through for processing to come into the United States is Ellis Island in New York City's harbor. At its peak, 1907, we're going to see every single day about 11,747 people being processed. That is a buttload of people, okay? The dining room of this building could hold 1,000 people. Immigrants had to answer 29 questions to gain citizenship. About 2% of people would fail, and that would be because they had a criminal record, they had some type of disease, or they did not give answers that were good enough. So, yeah. All right, now I want to show you guys just a quick video. It will take about 9 minutes, but it's really good at demonstrating the whole process from beginning to end of going through Ellis Island, essentially, especially if you're someone who has a disease that goes through, but it's not severe enough that you get sent back home over to Europe. And for those of you who were wondering, it is from the movie Godfather 2. So, yeah.
Thank you. is your name? What is your name?
Come on, son. What is your name?
Tuo nome? Vito Andolini from Corleone.
Corleone. Vito Corleone.
Okay. Over there. Next. Your name.
Tell him he has smallpox, quarantine 3 months.
Il dottore ha detto che hai il vaiolo, devi andare per 3 mesi in quarantena all'isola Ellis.
Vito Corleone.
There he is, this is him.
All right, so pretty interesting, right? Now, a number of us, that myself included, would have had relatives who went through this type of scenario, okay? All right, so moving on, we have cities, right? Now, horse-drawn carts, cable cars are being replaced by electric trolleys. Railways, subways, the first subways built in New York back in the late 1800s. We're going to see more of the upper middle class moving to the more into the outskirts of cities and what we call streetcar suburbs. So they are, you know, they're busing, they're taking public transport in and out of the city so they can go to their jobs and do what they're shopping, all that stuff, but then they're leaving the city to go home. We're going to see the first skyscrapers being built in 1885. So this is in Chicago. It's the Home Insurance Company building. It was 10 stories tall, which was very tall for the time. It was built with a steel frame to show that steel really was a huge deal during this time period. Now, a lot of immigrants would stay in New York City or they would travel to other places in the country where they may have already had, you know, friends or family already located. Now, a lot of them would live in urban areas. They had low paying jobs. But with all of this and, you know, having the upper and middle class people moving out, that's how we developed the suburbs. And that is how we become the first suburban nation, where we have these sub-city areas that stretch out from the cities themselves. But now these neighborhoods that a lot of the immigrants are moving into, they become these ethnic neighborhoods or ghettos, as they're also known as. So like an example here, you know, Chinatown. This could be, you know, New York, Philadelphia, Chicago, you know, any of those places. It could be San Francisco. There's a the Chinatown in a lot of these places. Right. A lot of people are going to be living in what are called tenements. They are small apartments, you know, maybe 1, 2, 3 rooms and not exactly good quality. They were cheap and they could fit, you know, as with buildings like these, you could fit as many as 4,000 people in one city block. That is a buttload of people in a very, very small area. All right. So now let's watch another little clip real quick. This one will...
While neighborhoods did provide a physical and emotional barrier to the outside world, living conditions in the tenements were primitive.
At the front of the building, there was a window. At the back of the building, there was a window. And in the middle, there were 2 rooms without windows. That's if you had 4 rooms. Some people only had 2 rooms.
We lived in a tenement building. There was the kitchen, the living room, and the bedroom. Now, my father and mother had one bed, and the children all slept in another bed. We slept sideways, and we, that young, they all fitted in. So there was, all six was lined up. In the summertime, I know several times I remember I sleep on a fire escape.
Even if you had your whole family with 3, 4, 5, 8 children, you still took in a boarder or two. People slept all over. They slept on the floor. They slept on the sofas. In some instances, in some cities, you had the beds being used 24 hours a day in 8-hour shifts. I mean, the poor people literally were on top of one another. And it was not a healthy situation.
The terrible world of the tenements gave rise to a new social reform movement. Reforms were passed, but slowly and with only modest gains for the immigrant tenants.
In 1901, New York State becomes the first state that requires windows to be built in every room and indoor plumbing in the buildings. So you can imagine what it was like before then. And if New York is the first state in 1901, what about all these other cities where people came? Boston, Pittsburgh, Philadelphia, Chicago, Cincinnati, and so forth.
While neighborhoods did provide a...
All right, so now a lot of issues, as we've seen with this type of housing situation, inadequate public services. So we're seeing a need for more public services like hospitals, police, schools, fire departments, street cleaning, garbage pickup, and they're just things that were not happening too much in these cities. So rich people are living next door to the poor. We're seeing luxuries of the wealthy, distressed poor, and increased social tensions, crime. So we need a revamping of the way these cities are being run and taken care of, right? So that's some of the problems that need to be addressed. We're also having to look at the Americanization of immigrants. So the people moving to the country, adapting to the way of life in this country. So not everybody is able to do these things, but these were things that were available to the immigrants who, had the opportunity financially to do so. So adults attending night school, learning English, being able to better educate themselves in the ways of America so that they can, get better jobs. Children, they are able to go to school where they are learn to speak and write and dress and act like Americans. In poorer families where maybe the parents can't take night school, the kids would then be teaching their parents what they learned in school that day, in the evenings. And because of this Americanization process, that is how America becomes known as the melting pot, because we are, by the process of bringing in the immigrants, we are combining all these cultures and melting them down together and becoming something that is uniquely American, which is a blending of everything. All right. Now we are going to see during this time period, the rise of political machines. Now what this means is they are basically a institution that is meant to keep one particular political party or group of people in power by doing favors in exchange for votes. So the city boss is the mayor or something like that. They have the city broken up into little sections, which are wards. And, they would be doing favors for the ward bosses in exchange for votes. And it would just be a trickle-down effect down to, the people who could vote in each little district. Now, political machines, there are pros and cons. Pros, No government assistance. Local politicians provide the social services to the people, so it's a lot more immediate. So like food, jobs, housing, hospitals, fire and police forces, things like that. Those are the pros. They happen a lot more quickly. The cons are a job you get might be a gift. There is a lot of illegal use of political influence for personal gain. So people are, they're skimming money off the top for themselves. There's a lot, tons of voting fraud, a lot of corruption. And one of the worst ones in American history is this guy right here, Boss Tweed. He was a boss, the boss of the local New York Democratic Party called Tammany Hall. And he would steal, you know, over $200 million from the New York taxpayers. He would eventually go to prison, but yeah. So now let's just watch a quick video on him and you'll get to learn all about how crazy this guy's life was and the things he was doing.
Fireman and one-time chairmaker from the Lower East Side. There had never been anyone quite like William M. Tweed. Over 6 feet tall and nearly 300 pounds, he was surprisingly nimble and graceful on his feet. Caricatured by his Republican opponents as a vulgar, hard-drinking Irishman, he was in fact a fourth-generation Scots Protestant, unfailingly courteous and nearly teetotal. He was also a superb politician, who took care of his mainly immigrant constituency, providing jobs for the unemployed, coal in winter, and orphanages, hospitals, and shelters for the poor.
He was one of the first people who saw the power of mass politics in the cities. And for all his thievery, there was the recognition of mobilizing this mass of people to some political end. I think he's not remembered for that. He's remembered for the $50 million that he stole, which if he wanted to get the equivalent today, multiply times 10.
Accelerating New York's already explosive growth still further, Tweed and his associates brazenly siphoned off staggering sums from the hundreds of city projects under their control and helped robber barons like Jay Gould and Jim Fisk make off with still more. There were lucrative contracts for grateful builders who happily paid Tammany's leaders enormous cash kickbacks to get them. There were thousands of jobs for Tammany's loyal constituents who gratefully voted Tammany's leaders back in power. New York's upper classes, meanwhile, professed to be appalled, but quietly looked the other way as real estate values in the city skyrocketed. It all worked like a machine, a political machine, and no one knew how that machine worked better than William Tweed, who by 1870 had concentrated more power in himself than anyone in the city's history.
It was Tweed who helped maneuver the money through the city council or the Board of Aldermen, as it then was, for the Brooklyn Bridge, for Central Park, for a lot of the road repair and the creation of streets and avenues in uptown Manhattan. Now, he made a lot of money with that. And it was absolutely corrupt.
Tweed's first position was Commissioner of Public Works. He was no fool. And if you know where the sewer lines are going to go, and if you know where the new street extensions are going to be opened up, and you get there first, and you buy up that territory, all you got to do is sit back, wait, and boom, the price explodes. So Tweed, in fact, became one of the largest real estate owners in the city.
I think there was something in him, some overpowering appetite that he could never slake. He couldn't have one mistress, he had to have two. He couldn't have one roast beef, he had to have four, you know? And he couldn't have two judges, he had to have them all, you know? And finally he caught up with them and destroyed them.
In 1870, as newspaper editors and indignant reformers began questioning where Tweed's lavish lifestyle came from, all eyes turned to the still unfinished county courthouse on Chambers Street, a special project of Tweed's. Begun in 1858, it was supposed to have cost $350,000. 12 years later, The price tag had reached $13 million and kept right on rising.
Somehow now this one building, which is actually quite a nice building, wound up costing more than the entire Houses of Parliament. Well, you know, the deal was straightforward. We want to buy a lot of chairs. How much does that chair cost? Let's say $5. No, says Tweed, you don't mean $5, you mean $50. Oh, I do? All right. And, you know, give me the chair, $50, you know, 20 back for you, and so forth.
Even the most worldly New Yorkers knew that something had to be done. People begin to tire of holding their noses, George Templeton Strong wrote, and are looking about in a helpless way for some remedy.
No caliph, Khan, or Caesar has risen to power or opulence more rapidly than Tweed the First. 10 years ago, this monarch was pursuing the humble occupation of a chairmaker. He now rules the state as Napoleon ruled France. There is absolutely nothing, nothing in the city which is beyond the reach of the insatiable gang who have obtained possession of it. The New York Times.
In 1869, a German-born artist named Thomas Nast, with close ties to the Republican Party, began publishing a series of political cartoons in Harper's Weekly. Week after week, Nast relentlessly excoriated what he called the Tammany Hall ring. There was Peter Brains Sweeney, the city treasurer. Mayor Abraham Oakey Hall, Tweed's puppet in City Hall. Richard Slippery Dick Connolly, the comptroller. And Boss Tweed himself, whom Nast depicted as a licentious, balding, overfed monster, literally devouring the city. I don't care a straw for newspaper articles, Tweed declared. My constituents don't know how to read, but they can't help seeing them damned pictures.
He was the object of one of the most successful campaigns by a political cartoonist in history. Thomas Nast really did the most extraordinary job of attacking Tweed and exposing the Tweed ring in Harper's Weekly. Those pictures will live forever. The way you can never separate Nixon from Woodward and Bernstein, you can't separate Tweed from Thomas Nast. They're wed together for the rest of history, I guess.
On July 8th, 1871, the New York Times joined the fray, publishing excerpts from secret courthouse records obtained from a disgruntled city official Tweed had cheated out of thousands of dollars in kickbacks. The figures were astonishing. 11 thermometers had been purchased for $7,500, dust brooms for $41,000. One contractor had been paid $5.5 million for window shades, carpets, and furniture. It would never be clear how much Tweed's corruption had been exaggerated by the press. The New York Times put the final tally at almost $200 million. But in the end, it didn't matter. New York needed a villain equal in scale to its giant park and giant bridge. And Tweed fit the bill, in part because he simply looked the part.
He ended up a sad, tragic figure because he basically took the fall for a system. And the system involved the bankers, the so-called respectable people, the Goulds and Fisks and all those guys who were not really indicted for the things that Tweed ended up doing, taking the fall for.
On December 15th, 1871, Boss Tweed was indicted on 3 counts of fraud and grand larceny. And 2 months later, 220 misdemeanor charges. He was sentenced to 12 years in prison, and though the convictions were later overturned, a civil suit stripped him of his assets and forced him into prison. Gaunt and ailing, he eked out his last years in jail. In the winter of 1875, he somehow slipped past his guards and escaped to Spain, but he was quickly recaptured and returned to prison. The Spanish police, it was later said, had recognized him from one of Thomas Nast's cartoons. On April 12, 1878, he died of pneumonia in his cell in the Ludlow Street jail he himself had built, penniless and broken.
He gets a lot of the blame, probably, that belongs to a lot more people, and a lot more people who we think of as legitimate politicians. There are other bosses that had a smoother style. I think part of the reason that people remember Boss Tweed so much was that he was so flamboyant, and by the time his downfall, he was such a leftover from another age.
A villain of more brains would have had a modest dwelling and guzzled in secret. His successors here will not imitate him in this, but that he will have successors, there is no doubt.
So, pretty interesting guy, right? Now, moving on. So, some other questionable things that happen. We're going to see Credit Mobler scandal, which was basically post-war years, notorious corruption. We're going to see a lot of manipulations happening with the reform bills. Insiders are giving stock to influential members of Congress. So there's a lot of payoffs going on, you know, going with dealing with the Transcontinental Railroad. President Grant would stay loyal to many dishonest people in his presidency. So like the first half of his presidency was really good. The second half was basically riddled with corruption and him kind of not doing much about it, sadly. All right. Rise of big business in these growing cities. Corporations, which is basically shared ownership and risk. That's the investors that are like, they own the stock in the companies. So they get to make, you know, decisions on how it's run. A very fast way to raise money is by having investors involved with the company. We're going to see the rise of monopolies where a company dominates a particular industry. Like, for instance, Rockefeller, his Standard Oil Company controlled 90% of America's oil production. That's a monopoly. They can basically set the prices however high or low they want. And we're going to see trusts. These are a set of companies managed by a small group of trustees. Trustees, they are the ones who have the power to prevent competition among companies. Now, example of a big business we have here. So think of all the different brands that you get at like a supermarket. A lot of them fall under one company, right? Like PepsiCo. Of course, you know, you have Pepsi, but they also control Quaker. They control a lot of different cereal brands, a lot of chip brands, a lot of other sodas and drink brands. You know, they are umbrella names for a lot of products, all right? So it's only like these, you know, 10 companies that own all of these smaller products. So yeah, that's kind of what we're talking about here. All right, now let's talk about, you know, limited competition. These are what trusted monopolies are doing. And they want to grow larger and more powerful. So, yeah. Now, captains of industry versus robber barons. This is more important right here. Now, the difference between the two is captain of industry is someone who's progressive, is bringing new ideas and new inventions to the people, to the country. A robber baron is basically someone who is keeping all the money for themselves and giving their employees very little to live on. They're raising, lowering the prices as they see fit, stuff like that. So let's look at some examples real quick. We have Andrew Carnegie, Scottish immigrant, very much rags to riches. He came to this country dirt poor and became one of the wealthiest men in all of American history, or world history, really. His fortune, due to inflation for today's money, he would be worth $372 billion, fifth richest person ever in world history. All right. But we're going to see later in life, he's going to become a bit of a philanthropist. So giving back his wealth to the people who need help. All right. You know, Carnegie Hall in New York City was built and named after him. It's a very very prestigious music hall. A lot of foundations are in place for him that help people and businesses and, you know, cities out. All right, Cornelius Vanderbilt. He started out with a steamboat business. He would sell it to get into the railroads, and he would become the railroad tycoon. So he would become a very wealthy man. The Vanderbilt University is named after him. And you know, their team, the Commodores, is taken from Vanderbilt's nickname, which was the Commodore. All right, JP Morgan, this guy, he would help form General Electric, which was like, Thomas Edison's electric company. So they worked together. He was the biggest financier of the late 1800s, early 1900s. Chase Bank was founded by him. He would bail out the U.S. government in 1907 when there was an economic panic. That's how much money this guy had to wield as well. All right. Now, John D. Rockefeller. This guy, he's Standard Oil controlled 90% of the oil supply in the U.S. by age 33. Started with one little store and pump when he was 29, and very, very quickly, he controlled dang near everything. The government would later force him to dissolve Standard Oil and into other companies, and they're still around today, like Chevron, Mobil, and Shell. He would give away millions in charity later on. He is the sixth richest person in history of the world with $341 billion. And to put that into perspective on the global scale, the only people richer than Carnegie and Rockefeller in world history are people whose wealth was incalculable. All right. Now, if you look at like the richest men in the world today, or people in the world today, they don't even come close to these types of numbers, all right? Elon Musk, just last month, January 7th, became the richest person in the world with only $185 billion. Of course, that's nothing to bat your eyes at, because that's an insane amount of money, and I wish I even had, 1% of that, okay? But, while that's insane, those fortunes like him and Jeff Bezos have, it's nothing compared to the other guys. All right. That is going to do it for today. Make sure you come back next time when we'll be talking about Jim Crow and segregation during the late 1800s and early 1900s.